Well, good morning, Santa Barbara Community Church. Those of you who are inside, so grateful to worship with you. Would you stand on up? And if you are outside on the patio, come on in. We would love to sing together. To sing to our Creator God, who created not only us, but this world that we see, My brother-in-law was visiting us this week, and he said, oh, so this is what you pay for. But the sunshine that we see, the good work in creation, the good work in those seated next to us that God has started and will continue on to completion. And we've just sung of that trajectory. Then who shall fall in bended knee? He shall return in power to reign. The thing that is constant through all of these ups and downs and the in-betweens as we live in the already but not yet has been the goodness of our God. Amen? And that's the thing that we can count on. As we look forward. As we celebrate his coming into Jerusalem this Palm Sunday. What was true back then and what is true now is that he has come to make all things new. And he is good. Would our response this morning be one of gratitude? Let's sing this, I love you.
Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Every breath that I
to sing. I will sing of the goodness of God all my life. You have been faithful. For others of us this morning, we're coming and it's a little harder to sing that. The circumstances in our lives have kind of blurred the faithfulness of God. Maybe some of us, our own decisions have led us what feels like is far away from God. But the bridge for those of you this morning who feel that way remains true, that the goodness of God is running after you. That's the word for you this morning. That His goodness chases after us. Let's sing that one more time. Your goodness.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
Your goodness.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
Just keep singing that. Your goodness.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness. Your goodness is running.
That's all right.
You can have a seat for a second. Oh, it's hot in here, and we're not talking about the temperature, y'all. Today is the week before Easter, and so we are celebrating our Palm Sunday. It is the day that Jesus entered into Jerusalem. Well, whether this is a new story for us, but even for those especially who have grown up in the church, I think it's so often for us to gloss over and kind of downplay really the controversy of what's going on Palm Sunday. So I want to just kind of set the stage for us today about what's going on Palm Sunday. Now, if you could look it up, scholars, they tell us that the Romans, of course, they're occupying Jerusalem, and the Romans believe that it is their belief and their destiny to rule over the world, that God has really ordained them and called them to rule over the entire world. So that's what the Romans believe. At the same time, the Jews are gathering from all over to celebrate this festival of Passover. And of course, Passover, for those of us who are familiar, is today, this festival when God, He originally delivered His people from an oppressive empire, Egypt. And so the Jews are gathering around, and very much on their minds is this thought of, God, do it again. Do it again. What You did before, do it again. And so we see this taking place, and to assert their dominance, the Romans, what they do is they call in a Roman legion, the greatest military force in all the world, come on in all your power and all your splendor, and come and march and parade through this region, parade through Jerusalem during this week, every day, what we call now Holy Week. Now, God's people, they're in the midst of this, and they have been taxed to death, so they're insecure financially. King Herod, he has installed his lackeys, his little loyalists, to run the temple, so the people of God are frustrated spiritually. And so you can imagine the Jewish people, in the midst of all their frustrations, with all their insecurities, with all their questions and doubts, they see on one side the Romans coming in, the soldiers marching in all their power and glory. And in the midst of that, they start hearing this commotion and this noise from this side. And there's this ragtag bunch of dudes coming in, poor, untrained, uneducated. And their leader's coming in on a donkey. And they're shouting out, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. This fulfills an Old Testament prophecy from Zechariah. Let's actually read this together, if you will. Let's read it. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And so what we see is really it's the kingdom of God versus the kingdoms of the world. That's what's taking place on Palm Sunday. And the question for the people back then and the question for us today is, where are we going to put our trust? Are we going to place our faith and our trust in the things of this world, which will not last? Or are we going to place our faith and trust completely in God? And of course, this is when we must cling to the word of God. We see passages in Psalm 118. Let's read this together as well. The Lord, let those, sorry. I call that out to the Lord. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I look in triumph on my enemies. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in humans. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. This passage here in Psalm 118 is actually the one in which the people's shouts are based upon here on Palm Sunday. This is a passage, Psalm 118, that was regularly read together by God's people during this week as they led up to the Passover. So I would like for us, Mike would like for us, who's not here right now, but he really, really wanted us, and I think it's great for us. Let's read this together, recognizing the history of this. And let's read it responsively. And the praise team's going to sing one more song and lead us in one more song. Let's actually rise together as we read this responsively, please. I'll read the regular text if you could read the bold, please. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Let Israel say,
his love endures forever.
Open for me the gates of the righteous.
I will enter and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.
The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes.
The Lord has done it this very day.
Let us rejoice today and be glad.
Hosanna, Lord, save us. Lord, grant us success. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine on us. With branches in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Let's read this last line together. His love endures forever. Amen.
I see the
Let's pray together, y'all. Heavenly Father, we thank you for gathering us here today, blessing us with this church family. We thank you for everyone here, regardless of where we are in terms of how we feel in our relationships with you. We thank you, God, that you are here, you are present, and you pursue us and you love us with a never-ending perfect love. We pray that, God, you would indeed be our only hope, our only trust, and that we would seek to solely live for you and love you with all of our hearts, minds, souls, and strength. Thank you for blessing us with one another here so that we can encourage each other, correct one another, rebuke one another, grow together, pick one another up in our pursuit of you. And Lord, we pray for one of our members, Patty Watts, as she will be having surgery to remove a brain tumor on April 11th. Lord, be with her, heal her. May the surgery go perfectly well and grant her and Kathy and Dan the faith and the strength that they need. And may they know that they are not alone, as God, you are with them, as well as this church family too. Lord, once again, we come to you in light of another tragic mass shooting, this time at a Christian school in Nashville, Tennessee. Lord, have mercy and provide comfort to those who have lost family and friends, to those who have lost their innocence and how their lives will never be the same again now. And along with this, Lord, how long do we need to keep on praying for your mercy and comfort due to these horrific events? How long, O Lord, must we wrestle with our thoughts and have sorrow in our hearts? Lord, we pray for your justice. We pray for your renewal. We pray that you would have your way in our lives and in our nation and in our government so that these horrible events would stop. And Lord, may we as your people, may we care and may we be actively engaged in seeking after these things until the day when you make all things right and you wipe away once and for all every tear that has ever been shed. Lord, as today is Palm Sunday, we recognize that you are our King and you are our Deliverer. Would you move in our hearts so that we would surrender our lives to you fully, to your kingdom work, to your purposes, to your mission. This Holy Week, may we be amazed and astounded by the life and the sacrificial death and the glorious resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And may you be with this church and the other churches in this region in a special and powerful and real and deep way. Lord, bring truth, bring renewal, bring restoration, bring salvation, all for your glory. And lastly, Lord, be with our brother Benji as he comes to teach us today from your word. Bless him, and may we have your hand of power and favor upon him as he continues to lead this church family. And may our hearts be ready and open to whatever you want to say and do today so that we will be conformed more and more into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Just want to share with you the announcements that are going on here in our church ministry. I apologize, we do have quite a few things because it's a very exciting time of the year. First of all, we have our Coffee Connect. So if you are new, you're visiting, and even if you've been here for a little while, but you want to learn more about the church, come on out, join us on the patio, look for the black bistro tables. If you don't know what that is, find me. And go and find us, get some snacks, talk to us. We would love to connect with you in that way. Secondly, lost and found. Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Go out. Save your lost items. Be like Jesus today. Go get your stuff. All right. It's getting thrown out after today, I was told. Third, Holy Week. Let's get to the important stuff. Holy Week. We have our Good Friday service this coming Friday here in this space at 7 p.m. It'll be for 1 hour. Children are welcome to worship with us as well. So come on out. Let's have a special time of worship on Good Friday here on Friday at 7. And then we have Easter Sunday. We're having one service next week at 9:30 at the West Lawn of Santa Barbara City College. It is a glorious and beautiful spot overlooking the ocean. There's free parking, I'm told, on the upper lots, and breakfast starts at 9. So if you come at 9:30, you're not getting breakfast, all right? Come at 9. We know that you come on time for food. Come at 9, get some food in you. We'll have a wonderful time together worshiping God on Easter. Invite some friends, invite family. Let's worship the Lord with joy and celebration. Can I get an amen? Come on now, say it with your chest. Can I get an amen? There you go. Let's worship God with joy and celebration. Amen. Let's go now. We do need your help, though. We need Easter help. If you are able to fill one of these roles that are listed here for Easter, sign up outside. There's some sign-up sheets out there, as well as you could do it on our app. As well, there'll be an email going out later this week, but I think it's easy just to do it today. Let's be overachievers. Knock it out today. Let's sign up and get involved in Easter. As well, today, we need your help. After this service, we are going to stack up the chairs in this spot. And so please help us for that. And Benji will have all the answers in terms of how we're doing that. Because I don't know. With that, let's all stand up and let's greet one another with the peace and love of Christ.
All right, y'all. I'm going to invite you to return to your seats now. Go ahead and return to your seats. As you already heard, my name's Benji, and I serve as one of the pastors here, and we're going to get to God's Word in just a moment, but before we do, we have one last announcement. Many of you will have heard about this through your email on Friday, but we are really excited about God's provision of Kim Ferrado, who is joining our staff in the role of Elementary Ministry Coordinator. Yeah, absolutely. Totally. Kim has a deep love of and knowledge of this church family already. She's been serving for many years. We are really excited to have her. If you missed that email, it gives more context on kind of the structure of children's ministry and the different remarkable women who are serving those roles. And so be sure to look back at that. But we are just so thrilled to have Kim. Well, we are going to turn our attention now to the book of Matthew. And I want to know if you have a favorite book series. Many of us have favorite books, but favorite book series. I want you to think of it for a moment. If you have a favorite book series, you already know that sense of anticipation and even a little bit of excitement as you reach sort of the crescendo of the story, the crescendo of the action. Well, today and next Sunday, over the next 2 weeks, we are going to reach the climactic action of Matthew's gospel. Now, it won't come as a surprise if you've been tracking Matthew's gospel because Jesus has been clear throughout the gospel where this is all headed. And we get one of our clearest examples in Matthew chapter 20 we looked at not too long ago. Jesus said, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. On the third day, he will be raised to life." Well, that is what we're going to look at today and next week. Now, as Ken reminded us already, today is Palm Sunday on the church calendar, the day that kicks off Holy Week. But in our study of Matthew's gospel, which we began back in January of 2022, we looked at the events of Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, on February 19th, which means that everything that we have considered in the last seven sermons has all been part of one very eventful week for Jesus in Jerusalem. Just last week, Joanne took us through a significant portion of chapter 26. She encouraged us to read through the entire thing. And if you did that, you will know that the story heads toward the end of that chapter with Jesus praying in Gethsemane, praying to his Father, expressing both deep sorrow and his deep commitment to his Father's plan. We are going to pick up the story today in Gethsemane in Matthew 26, verse 45. You can open your Bible there if you haven't already. Now, I want you to know that this week's reading is one of the lengthiest you will ever hear in this church. But I decided to keep it all together so that we might encounter the entire story at once. Because it's so lengthy, I've asked a couple of friends to come help me with the reading. So as Margaret and Micah make their way up, I want... Whoa, you clapping. We're going to have some clapping instructions on when and not... Anyhow. I want you to know you can remain seated for this extended scripture reading, but I want to challenge you to truly engage, even as you're seated. For many in this room, this will be very familiar territory, but for some, this may be brand new. And I want to say, whether you're encountering this text of scripture for the first time or the 91st time, we each need to allow these words to sink into our heart. So hear the reading of God's word from Matthew chapter 26, beginning in verse 45.
Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer." While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. "The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached out for his sword, drew it, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you not think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen this way?" In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple, in the courts, teaching. You did not arrest me then. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. But Peter followed him at a distance, right up to the courtyard of the high priest. He entered and sat down with the guards to see the outcome. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward and declared, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'" Then the high priest stood up and said to Jesus, "Are you not going to answer? What is this testimony that these men are bringing against you?" But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said to him, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." "You have said so," Jesus replied. "But I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, now you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" "He is worthy of death," they answered. Then they spit in his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said, "Prophesy to us, Messiah. Who hit you?"
Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another servant girl saw him and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again with an oath. "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately, a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me 3 times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. Early in the morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people made their plans how to have Jesus executed. So they bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. The chief priests picked up the coins and said, "It is against the law to put this into the treasury, since it is blood money." So they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for the foreigners. That is why it has been called the field of blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 pieces of silver, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field as the Lord commanded me.
Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now, it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Jesus Barabbas. So, when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called Messiah?" For he knew that it was out of self-interest that they had handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message: "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of these two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed over to be crucified. Then the governor's soldiers took Jesus to the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And then they twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. They knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said, and they spit on him and took the staff and struck him on his head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him, and they led him away to crucify him.
As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall, but after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the rebels who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. From noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over all the land. About 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Many women were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons.
As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite the tomb. The next day, the one after Preparation Day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Margaret and Micah. You can pick up your Endurance Bible Reading Merit Badge on the way out. So obviously there is so much we could unpack from these verses, but we're not going to because it would take us all of Holy Week. Instead, what I want to do is just ask two big questions of this passage. Now, in my experience, most of us are naturally wired to engage with the scriptures with either our mind or our heart in the driver's seat. Now, I'm a mind-forward kind of person. I often find myself responding to the text of Scripture with questions about original word meaning or historical or literary context, connections to other scriptures, etc. Any other mind in the driver's seat people with me? Yes, thank you. Appreciate you. Now, I hear tell of another kind of person altogether. A person who responds to a text with their heart. They feel the emotions of the scriptures. They imagine themselves in the place of the characters. These are people who feel the text first. Any heart in the driver's seat, people? Yeah, I see you. I don't always understand you, but I see you. Well, good news. No matter how you're wired, this text has something for each of us today because I think it prompts one big question for the heart and one big question for the mind. So let's start with our mind-forward question, and it's simply this. What was the reason for the cross? Remember that favorite book series I mentioned? So I want you to imagine for a moment jumping into book two without having read book one. It could be hard to make sense of a lot of what's going on. In fact, you could even totally misunderstand the nature, the trajectory of the story itself. So to avoid doing that with the cross, I want to spend the next few minutes reminding us of a much larger story than the one that we just read, a story that begins in Genesis 1 and 2. The opening chapters of the Bible tell a story of remarkable beauty and creativity, as God creates the world and all that's in it out of the overflow of his love and his glory. The result is a world that is perfectly suited for divine image bearers to relate in harmony with him, in harmony with one another, and to extend God's good and loving rule throughout the earth. And yet that story goes desperately wrong in Genesis 3 when the man and the woman, our original parents, choose to reject God's benevolent rule. They choose to live as their own authority, and in doing so, they join a cosmic rebellion led by God's great enemy. Now, in a stunning twist in that story, the Almighty Creator God does not respond as we might imagine. Instead of treating the whole thing like a bad rough draft and crumpling it up and throwing away, instead, he insists on rescuing these rebels from the mess that they themselves have created, which brings us to some of the cleaner pages of our Bible. By that I mean from lack of fingerprints, not because of the content, as you're about to see. So the last few chapters of the book of Exodus show God giving instructions for a tent that was known as the tabernacle. It was a temporary structure for worship of him that would one day give way to the temple. Now, immediately following Exodus comes a book that most of us don't do our devotionals in, the book of Leviticus. Now, the book of Leviticus opens with instructions about the sacrifices that should take place in the tabernacle. There were a variety of sacrifices, but at the heart of the whole thing was the sacrifice known as the sin offering. I want you to hear just one section of the description of the sin offering from Leviticus chapter 4. If someone brings a lamb as their sin offering, they are to bring a female without defect. They are to lay their hand on its head and slaughter it for a sin offering at the place where the burnt offering is slaughtered. Then the priest shall take some of the blood of the sin offering with his finger and put it on the horns of the altar of burnt offering and pour out the rest of the blood at the base of the altar. They shall remove all the fat, just as the fat is removed from the lamb of the fellowship offering, and the priest shall burn it on the altar on top of the food offerings presented to the Lord. In this way, the priest will make atonement for them for the sin they have committed, and they will be forgiven. So although gory, it's fairly straightforward. It's a simple equation. An unblemished offering can secure forgiveness for sins. And yet, this system created one problem in the hearts of people and highlighted another problem with people's hearts. Over time, the sacrificial system became little more than ritual for many in Israel. This ritual that was meant to stir in the hearts of people true repentance that revealed that they belonged to a God of grace, instead led people's hearts to believe that because they belonged to a God of grace, the ritual alone would suffice in place of true repentance. Which brings us to our vocabulary word for the day. High school students, this is SAT level prep right here, so lock in for a minute. Can you say the word perfunctory? No, really, say it, perfunctory. We can do this. Our friends at dictionary.com help out. Perfunctory, adjective, performed merely as a routine duty, hasty and superficial, lacking interest, care, or enthusiasm, indifferent, or apathetic. Now, perfunctory is not only a really fun word to say, it's also a perfect word to describe the worship situation for much of the people of Israel. Now, you may be asking, well, how do you know, Benji, that the sacrificial system became perfunctory? Well, because God tells us so through the scriptures. We get a prominent example in the opening chapter of Isaiah. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me? Says the Lord. I have more than enough of burnt offerings, of rams, and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons, Sabbaths, and convocations, I cannot bear your worthless assemblies. Your new moon feasts and your appointed festivals, I hate with all my being. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I hide my eyes from you. Even when you offer many prayers, I am not listening. And you may be asking, why is that? God says, your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Through Isaiah, God declares that his longing is not the empty ritual of bringing sacrifices, but changed hearts and lives for those who know the grace of bringing the blood of another in place of their own. So if the first issue with the sacrificial system is that it became empty ritual, the second problem is that it revealed a deeper need. Have you ever been invited to an event that is billed as the first annual whatever it may be? I always find myself thinking, that seems a little presumptuous. What if this whole thing's a train wreck? Then you have t-shirts and wine glasses out in the wild, and that's going to be awkward for you. One of the primary texts about the sacrificial system is found in Leviticus 16, which outlines the specifics of what is known as the Day of Atonement, or Yom Kippur. Now, at the very end of this chapter, after detailing a very elaborate process by which the high priest offers a sacrifice of atonement on behalf of the entire nation, God includes this statement in the final verse of the chapter. This is to be a lasting ordinance for you. Atonement is to be made once a year for all the sins of the Israelites. That is the first annual Day of Atonement, which in this case is not presumptuous because of God's knowledge of the human heart. The human sin condition is so deeply ingrained that God knew from the outset that the Day of Atonement would need to be a repeated event, which means that while the sacrificial system could serve to recognize sin, it could never truly remedy sin. So year after year, Israel brought what God asked, but the repetition itself pointed to a deeper need that the blood of livestock couldn't possibly begin to touch. And then, one day, an eccentric desert preacher performing baptisms in the Jordan River stopped what he was doing, pointed to Jesus of Nazareth, and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." This is a truth that Jesus himself highlighted in the passage we considered just last week, when he offered his friends a cup of Passover wine and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Goats and lambs pointed to the need for atonement, but only human flesh and blood could make true atonement for human sin. So the author of Hebrews reminds us, since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For this reason, he had to be made like them, fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. In Matthew 27, we see the bloody culmination of Jesus' mission of rescuing love, to offer his unblemished, fully human life in exchange for the sin of each of us. On the cross, for the first and the last time, Jesus experienced distance from God the Father so that rebels like us could draw near. Now, we've spent a fair amount of time with our minds in the driver's seat, so let's allow our hearts to buckle up behind the wheel for a moment and consider this second question. What is our response to the cross? I'm really fascinated by the various groups of people in this text. Jesus is clearly the main focus. He's the central character in this whole narrative, but there are so many different groups of people and individuals who respond in a variety of ways, ways that many of our hearts might be similarly drawn to. Because make no mistake, this text demands a response from each of us, no matter what's going on in our hearts this morning. Perhaps like Judas, you find that Jesus isn't quite living up to the hype, not meeting your expectations, and you're ready to give up on the whole thing. Perhaps like the disciples in the garden, you have decided that life with Jesus simply requires too much, so you've run from him. Perhaps like the religious leaders of Israel, you consider Jesus a bit of a dreamer and probably a danger, and you can't quite allow your heart to believe he is who he claims to be. Perhaps like Peter in the courtyard, you don't mind hanging around near Jesus, but open association with him is a little bit embarrassing. So your heart would rather downplay your connection to him and preserve your social standing. Perhaps like Pilate, you find Jesus fascinating but troublesome, a disruption, perhaps an inconvenience to the life that you were hoping to lead. Perhaps like the crowds that gathered at Pilate's palace, your heart would rather have any king but Jesus, so you can live by your own vision, your own philosophy of life. Perhaps like the governor's soldiers, you find Jesus to be little more than an object of scorn, worthy of ridicule, never respect. Perhaps like Simon of Cyrene, you find yourself swept up into Jesus' story and not by your own doing. The faith of your parents or your friends has gotten you tangled up in something you're not quite sure you're ready to be a part of. Perhaps like those who passed by the cross, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, the elders, and the criminals who hung beside him, your heart simply mocks this one who met such an inglorious fate. Or perhaps, like the centurion, sent by Rome to keep the Jews in their place, despite your background and your story, you're surprised at your own journey of beginning to see the true identity and beauty of Jesus. Or perhaps, like the devoted women who cared for him, you've resolved to stay near to Jesus, even if the road leads to terrifyingly dark places. Or perhaps, like Joseph of Arimathea, who the other Gospels tell us was a member of the Jewish religious ruling council, you simply know that though it may cost you your own status, your own comfort, your own reputation, and your own riches, you will be known as a disciple of Jesus. Now, I don't know what this text prompts in your heart, but I do know that there is nobody in this room by accident today. Whether you came in as a skeptic or a seeker, a doubter or a disciple, this text is meant to unsettle each and every one of us by reminding us of the gravity of sin and the beauty of a substitute. Because, friends, unlike your favorite book series, this true story demands a response, because this is no normal death. We are too painfully aware that the tragedy of death is a daily part of life in our broken world, yet only one death in all of history went down like this. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. It's as though heaven and earth themselves are crying out, "Pay attention! God's great cosmic rescue plan is here." Friends, the communion between God and his image bearers that was damaged in the garden has been restored through Jesus' faithfulness unto death. So listen to how the Apostle Paul declares this good news. When you were dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. For those who know the joy of canceled debt, who know what it is to be made alive in Christ, who know the freedom of having sin taken away, there's a meal before us. At this table, we take broken bread and we remember Jesus's broken body. And we dip it in wine and we remember Jesus's shed blood. And we do so not only to remember the sacrifice that secured our forgiveness, but to declare the praise and glory of the God of great rescues. This is a meal of deep gratitude for those whose sins have been nailed to the cross of Christ. So if you are among those rescued by Christ's sacrifice, I invite you to come to the table. If this text has left you wondering about your relationship to this substitute, as always, we will have prayer teams on either side. They would love nothing more than to talk with you and to pray with you about these things or really anything at all. But let's continue in our worship of the one who came out of love to rescue rebels like you and like me. Amen.
Redemption's hill, where your blood was spilled, for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross. To my knees, Lord, I lay me down.
overwhelmed and I cannot hear your voice. I'll hold on to what is true, though I cannot see. If the storms of life they come and the road ahead gets steep, I will lift these hands in faith. I'll remind myself of all that you've done and the life I have because of your son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours. I am forever yours. Mountain high or valley low, I sing, I remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours. When my heart is filled with hope, you're singing that well, you're singing that loud, and it's a joy to come in as adopted sons and daughters of the High King of Heaven. Sometimes we can forget, though, that that adoption came at a price, and that's what this week we journey towards, remembering the price that was paid and the resurrection of our King Jesus. And as we've sung this together, I am yours. There are many of us in here that can sing that wholeheartedly, but there's a world out there that needs to know that there's a king who invites them in. Amen? Amen. And so tomorrow night, 7:30, our last Lenten worship session, we're going to be contending for the salvation of friends and family that we know. So come pray with us. Come sing with us. Join us in worship. But as you go this week, would that be on your mind? That this is not just for us in this room, but he's come that all the earth would shout his praise. Amen. Go in the peace and the love and the joy of our King Jesus this week. We'll see you soon.